So HPB versus Darth Vader. I wonder if I should disclose the code to the title of my talk at the beginning or at the end. I'll see. I'll think about it. I think everyone in this room would agree that for all the depth of our love for HPB, for the great influence that she left us and others in the culture, she really is an enigma. She really is an enigma. Here we are at this conference, well over a century after the founding of the Theosophical Society, and we're asking ourselves some of the same questions that people asked while HPB was here with us. Who is she? Who is this eternally confounding woman? This scholar, this seeker, this instigator, this revolutionary, this brilliant observer, this satirist, this truth teller, this idealist, this world traveler. She has no antecedent. She has no antecedent. And a friend of mine puts it this way. Very often, when people encounter things that they haven't seen before and that they can't put into any neat little box or category, they immediately start using analogies. Here come the analogies, you know. The teaching of Gurdjieff is like the teaching of X. The insights of Jung are like the insights of this. Madame Blavatsky is like, you know, fill in the blank. She wasn't like anything. She wasn't like anything, which is why it's difficult for contemporary Westerners to talk about her in a meaningful way, because we are educated, or perhaps miseducated, to try to always leap to these comparisons. This is like this, this is like that. She's not like anything. Several weeks ago, a reporter from the New York Times called me up. He wanted to interview me about 19th century spiritualism because he was writing a feature piece about a woman on the west side of Manhattan who is a stage magician, and she recreates certain 19th century seances. And the assumption he had was that I would agree with the general cultural bias that they had, that, you know, seances can be interpreted and understood along the lines that, you know, Houdini viewed them, for example, as nothing but parlor tricks aimed at fooling the weak-minded. And we talked about a whole range of things, and he seemed to enjoy the conversation a great deal. He seemed to appreciate that someone was challenging that point of view. And we didn't talk much about HPB, but when the article came out, there were some derogatory comments about HPB, and this woman, the stage magician, said that she was repeating some of the things that HPB did, some of the phenomena at the Lamasery, and she said, well, you know, we know how she did it, you know, X, Y, Z. And I wrote back to the reporter and I said, you know, I enjoyed the piece, you know, in terms of learning about this person's show, but I have very different views of HPB, and I think that's very incomplete. And I was struck that these comments were made without examination. There was no forensic examination of what the person was talking about. Now, I'm not here to sell anybody on a particular belief system. I have no vested interest in someone sharing my outlook, but I do have a vested interest in striving for a certain excellence in examining things. And there was no forensic examination whatsoever, nor any note or comment that no forensic examination existed, you know, to back up this casually tossed off judgment. So again, we see an example of saying, well, HPB is, it's like this, it's like that. We reach for things that we know about, and we try to put that as a permanent label on the figure. But HPB keeps bursting the bell jar. She cannot be put under it. And if you notice, Our materialist culture keeps trying to restore the bell jar, and they can't. Several years ago, I went to my friend Gary Lachman, a historian who some of you may know, and I said to him, you know, there needs to be sort of an introductory general interest biography of HPB. Not the last word, not something epic, but something that an interested young person or a journalist or what have you can use as a reference point. So we did publish a nice biography of Madame Blavatsky, which is in paperback. It's available in the library, maybe the bookstore as well. And to my shock, we got requests for the book far and wide from places including the Paris Review and Harper's Magazine, both of which wrote attacks on the book and HPB. And I was with Gary at a conference not long after, and I said, why do these people even care? You know, we don't bother them. We're not asking them for anything. I never even sent them the book. It didn't even occur to me. They sought us out, sought out the book, because they needed to take some column space, you know, here 130 years later to attack HPB, to attack HPB. Why? Is it necessary? Why do they care? I think they care. I think they are afflicted with an internal discomfort around Madame Blavatsky because we are not educated in our culture to hold questions. We have to label things. It is this obsessive trait of the Western mind. And this figure, who really cannot be put under any canopy or label, is an object of persistent frustration. Persistent frustration. The book should be closed on her by now. This should be finished. And there's this resentment, it seems to me, that it's not finished. So they keep trying to restore the bell jar, and HPB keeps shattering the bell jar. That's the way it is. Interestingly enough, because HPB cannot be understood in our popular culture, she instead serves as a mirror of our popular culture. People sometimes say she was opaque. I'm not sure she was opaque, but it is an interesting choice of words because when something is opaque, it just reflects ourselves back to us. And that's what happens in our culture. HPB in the popular culture reflects back to us who we are and the quality of our thought. Here's an interesting example. I was shocked when I discovered this, and some of you may actually remember it. It involves the author Truman Capote, who you all know. When Truman Capote, this chic New York writer, brilliant short story writer, outstanding journalist, published his book In Cold Blood in 1966. For a period of time, he came to be seen as an authority on crime. The book was about some brutal murders in the American West. And starting in 1968, Capote made a series of appearances on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson. And it was funny, Johnny Carson was actually a very well-read man, an interesting man. He had a lot of literary guests, especially in the early days. If you go online, you can watch an episode, one of several, of Johnny interviewing the philosopher Ayn Rand. And it's so interesting and funny because he's sitting there with his sidekick, Ed McMahon. You remember Ed McMahon. And Ed McMahon is very earnestly asking Ayn Rand questions. You know, Ed is sitting there with his legs crossed going, so do you think capitalism retards the influence of the spirit? And, you know, it's so funny to see these guys who, you know, generally are talking to, you know, movie stars having this philosophical discussion. But there it was. And so Johnny is interviewing Truman Capote. It's the summer of 1968. It's a tense time in America because the country has just experienced the assassination of both Martin Luther King and Bobby Kennedy. And people are very tense, not unlike some of what we're experiencing today. And Capote, astoundingly, on Johnny Carson's show, holds forth on this idea that Madame Blavatsky had this theory of occult political revolution in which if you assassinated a series of prominent figures, you could destabilize a society and thereby bring in some kind of political occult overthrow of the prevailing order. You all remember this from ISIS Unveiled, right? Yeah, right. Chapter 3. And he said that Madame Blavatsky had produced this manual for revolution, which laid out these ideas in which by the systematic assassination of prominent figures you could destabilize a society. Complete and utter fantasy. It gets picked up in Time magazine, among other places, and this is the great part. The ultra-right-wing John Birch Society decides to make a kind of titular alliance with the chic New York writer Truman Capote and starts taking out ads in American newspapers, including one in Fresno, California. Fresno, yes. in which they decry this manual for revolution produced by the 19th century Russian occultist H.P. Blavatsky, and we've got to get to the bottom of this. Now, Capote is no longer with us, so I can't ask him, where did you get this idea? But it seems to me that he got this imaginary idea, in part, from something having to do with the assassin of Bobby Kennedy, a man named Sirhan Sirhan, who, while he was in prison, requested and received, as is his right, copies of The Secret Doctrine, and also copies of a book by Mr. Leadbeater, Talks on at the Feet of the Master. It was Leadbeater's commentaries on the book At the Feet of the Master. And he also requested some ordinary books and magazines. I'm not sure he ever read any of this material. He was not a theosophist. He was a member of the Rosicrucian order Amorc in San Jose, but they removed him from the membership rolls because he was delinquent in paying a $2 publications fee for books that he had borrowed. That was the grand connection from which Truman Capote interpreted this, this fantasy. And again, you would have cause to think that a figure like Truman Capote wouldn't have heard or much cared about Madame Blavatsky, but she formed this gravitational point of complete imagination for him, and I suppose became some sort of a reflection of the general tension that was at play in the culture at the time, and I think also the proclivity of celebrities to want to say things that are outrageous in order to be invited back on the Johnny Carson show. And apparently it worked, but it didn't make very good history, unfortunately. Another and grimmer myth that gets promulgated to this day in the popular culture is that Madame Blavatsky had some sort of connection to or that her writing served as an influence for the Third Reich. This is not true. This is false. And this can be understood if people take the time out to look at a little history. And I will take a very quick jog through it here. I go through the story in my book, Occult America, along with the Truman Capote story. I so wish he was around so I could ask him about this, but I have to just piece it together. I was having lunch with a television host a couple of years ago, and he made the remark at the table that Madame Blavatsky was an anti-Semite and that her teachings were at the heart of the Third Reich. And I said to him, that is absolutely false. And you know, here I am at a professional lunch where I'm supposed to be kissing up to a television host. But these things cannot be said without correction. And I said, look, I'm sorry. That's absolutely false. If you want to read the facts, you can take a look in my book, Occult America. There was no such truth to the connection whatsoever, and utterly no truth to that whatsoever. The truth is, to put it very, very briefly, when the secret doctrine was written, it opened a door in the European psyche that had been closed for several generations to ideas of the esoteric. It introduced symbols and concepts with great validity that for many, many generations, if not centuries, going back to the occult renaissance, had been unknown or very, very little known to the Western psyche. One of these images was the swastika, the symbol of eternal recurrence, which we are proud to use in a loving and historically valid way on our own insignia, along with the Ankh and the Star of David, the Om symbol, and other symbols. The symbol of, it is the Vedic symbol, originally, of eternal recurrence, of karma. It expresses an ancient value. In the late 19th, early 20th century, there was a revival in all kinds of folk customs in Europe, including the use of Germanic runes. Early racial theorists, racialist backwards theorists, who influenced Nazi ideology, falsely conflated the swastika with Germanic runes. Why? Because many of these theorists were interested in detaching Western culture from its Mediterranean origins, as Stefan Heller was referencing in his talk yesterday. We in the West are people of Mediterranean origins, Hellenic and Semitic. And the early Nazis wanted to erect a fantasy in which they had no connection whatsoever to the Abrahamic or Semitic cultures of the Mediterranean basin. Hence, it was historically convenient, if false, to associate Germanic runes with symbols from the Veda, as if to say, we are Aryan people, making reference to ancient people from the Indus Valley in the area that is now part of modern India. They made this connection with historical falsehood, with racist intentions, and with the idea, in their backwards view of the world, of cleansing the German character of Mediterranean, thus Semitic and Abrahamic, roots. In this morass and confusion that they purposefully pursued, the swastika was adopted as the party symbol. Also because it is a compelling symbol, as are the symbols of the Ankh and the Star of David and the cross. But those are problematic to that mindset because they're from the Mediterranean. There are Hellenic, Abrahamic bases for those symbols. So it's more convenient to adopt a compelling visual symbol, a magnetic visual symbol, that they perceive as being from another branch of humanity entirely. Hence, we have the twisted, thorny path, which I have described only in brief, as to how the Nazis seized upon this beautiful, beneficent symbol and perverted it, perhaps forever, into something associated with an intractable evil. It had nothing to do with HPB. It had nothing to do with her intentions, and she would have decried such a thing in the strongest terms. But again, we in our culture like playing games with conspiracies, with all kinds of dark theories and ideas, so it becomes easy across a lunch table for someone to make a remark like that to me, someone of some influence. These remarks won't stick. They won't stick, but they do create a lot of friction. I'll speak now of a brighter influence of Madame Blavatsky in our culture. I'm smiling because it's a very indirect influence. It's a very subtle influence. And I think it probably involves some leaps of fantasy, but there's a certain idealism to it. So I kind of like it. Madame Blavatsky, subtly, indirectly, was an influence on a very promising young man who rose to some heights in America named Ronald Reagan. And I'll tell you about that family tree of influence. It's funny, you cannot turn a page in our modern history without Madame Blavatsky looking back at you somewhere. Christopher Bamford, the historian, has reckoned that maybe Madame Blavatsky should be ranked with Freud, Einstein, and Marx as one of the great sources of modern culture. And there are times I think he was really right. Because she just appears behind every curtain when you're taking a look at how we got to where we are. So, Madame Blavatsky opened the Western mind, as I was describing the other day, I think, to the contemporary idea, the contemporary iteration of the man of wisdom, the robed teacher from the East who drank from very, very deep waters and who had something to offer the seeker from the West. You could find aspects of that, aspects of the man of wisdom in Western culture other times, of course, Merlin, the figure of Christ himself, the prophets. But Madame Blavatsky reignited that notion into the contemporary Western mind, I think, with a special romance and sense of possibility, that this didn't just belong to some distantly shrouded past, but connecting with invisible help, connecting with the man of wisdom was a possibility, or at least connecting with the tradition emanating from such a person was a possibility for the earnest contemporary person. So, let me give you a little case in point, and then I'll go backwards and tell you where it came from. I was doing a radio show in New Orleans, and during a commercial break, the host said to me, "Hey, did you know that Ronald Reagan believed in the masters or the Mahatmas?" And I said, "No, I didn't know that. Tell me about it." So he directs me to a little essay that Reagan wrote. In 1981, Reagan was asked by Parade magazine, you guys know Parade magazine, it comes as a supplement sometimes to the newspaper, to write a personal essay on what the 4th of July meant to him. So, you know, early in his career, Reagan wrote a lot of his own speeches, articles, commentaries. Sometimes later he would write them himself, and then the speechmakers would come in and embellish and so forth. So at Camp David, on a yellow legal pad in longhand, Reagan writes out this essay for Parade magazine, which gets published in July of 1981, on what the 4th of July means to him personally. And in it, the president tells this strange story of the delegates gathering at the State House in Philadelphia on July 4th, 1776, for what is supposed to be the signing of the Declaration of Independence, and they start to waver. And there's a certain fear and hesitancy running through the room because everybody in the room realizes, look, you put your signature on this document, that could be the end of you. You can be executed. And so, as Reagan describes it, suddenly, this wise, compelling old man stands up at the back of the room, an unknown stranger. And no one knows how he got in through the locked doors of the State House. No one had noticed him before. And he gives this rousing speech telling the delegates that this country, this dawning republic, was set aside by a great school of wisdom to be an experiment in democracy and religious freedom. And by signing your names to this document, you will not be signing your death warrant. You will be signing your own statement of immortality, because you will be seeing through the fulfillment that the ancient brotherhood has planned for in setting aside this nation between the oceans that can protect the individual search for meaning. And Reagan writes, everybody applauds, and the delegates go rushing up to fix their name onto the Declaration of Independence. And the rest, as they say, is history. And then after that, the delegates are looking around for this wonderful unknown orator to shake his hand, but he was gone. He had slipped out of the locked doors of the State House, past the guards, unaware. And I thought, oh, okay. I never learned that in high school, but thank you, Mr. President. Now, you know, over the years, there were rumors that spread, you know, who was the shadowy figure? He was Saint Germain. He was Master Moria. He was one of the so-called ascended masters, you know, the favorite term of the New Age. And I read this essay and I said to my friend, wow, that's different. But I was struck by more than just this unusual story. I was struck by something else. I said, gosh, I've seen this language before. I've seen this phraseology before. Where? And I realized it. Manly P. Hall. Yeah, it appears in the book, The Secret Destiny of America, which Manly wrote and published in 1944. And I thought, no. So I get my copy of The Secret Destiny of America. Now look, stories change hands, you know, Peter tells Paul, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Doesn't mean it comes from that source. But I'm reading it, and by God, there is exact phraseology corresponding between Manly's account and between Reagan's account. It is a dead-to-right fact that Reagan was deriving ideas and specific phrases from Manly's account. I later wrote about this for the Washington Post. You can find it online. It's an article called Reagan and the Occult. And then I said, well, where does the story come from? Now, Manly wasn't very clear about where it came from. He said he got it from a book of early American oratory that had been given to him by a secretary of the Theosophical Society of America. And sure enough, I go over to the Selin Library in New York to see my friend Michael Gomes, and we pull out old issues of The Theosophist, and there it is, The Speech of the Unknown, from a 1938 issue of the newsletter, The Theosophist. Well, where did it come from? I'm still wondering. Now, look, this is the best I've been able to do on this, and I really love romance, you know, I gotta tell you. But this is where it came from. It came from a book that was written and published in 1849 by a journalist and essayist named George Lippard. George Lippard, who was a friend of the writer Edgar Allan Poe and who had a taste for Gothic imagery. And Lippard wrote this account in 1849 of an unknown speaker bolstering the spirits of the delegates. And in a rather veiled way, and I go through it in Occult America, he acknowledged that it was a metaphor in which he wanted to sum up some of the idealism of the time. The idealism of the time, and he had the figure as a cloaked, mysterious figure who snuck in and snuck out. It had all the markings of the account that later appeared in Manly and then appeared in Ronald Reagan. But it was interesting to me because here you have this indirect beeline of influence going from HPB all the way up through one of the most popular presidents of the 20th century, and it is this. HPB introduces this idea of the intercessor, the adept, the master, the figure of wisdom, the invisible helper who comes from we know not where, who imparts some wisdom, help, assistance, and then disappears from the scene. Okay, she introduces into the Western mindset or reintroduces that idea. You have many, many, many years later, Manly P. Hall, who acknowledged that he wasn't entirely sure about the story, repeating it, taking it seriously enough to say, look, at the very least, it does capture an aspect of American idealism, thinking highly enough of the story, which he received from a secretary of the Theosophical Society and through an issue of the Theosophist. Manly takes it seriously enough to say, well, look, you know, metaphor or not, it does capture something of the idealism of the American enterprise. And Manly believed and took very seriously the idea that America, as a laboratory of religious experiment, as a society that protected the individual search for meaning, was in fact the culminating achievement of a family tree of wisdom that extended back to primeval antiquity, that was preserved through the values and ideals of esoteric societies, ranging from the Rosicrucians to the Freemasons to Theosophists, and that this ideal was in fact realized among a group of founders who, for whatever their faults, many of whom were Freemasons, John Hancock, Paul Revere, George Washington, Ben Franklin, it's not a fantasy, it's the truth, many of whom were Masons, many of whom had heterodox religious ideas. Thomas Jefferson decided in his spare time that he would re-edit the Bible into a version that he found suited to his outlook. It's called the Jefferson Bible. It's actually a wonderful document. John Adams agreed with Jefferson that Christ was an extraordinary ethical philosopher, but they both agreed in private that some of the retelling of his story had been rendered into fanciful versions over the years. You have these religious but quite heterodox founders, some of whom are Freemasons. I think probably Francis Yates, who's one of my great heroes, has made the case rather compellingly that early Freemasonry adapted some of his ideas and may have actually grown from the intellectual movement called Rosicrucianism, which was in itself a movement that served as a capsule for some of the occult ideas that reemerged during the Renaissance period before there was a backlash. These ideas, of course, extend back to Egypt, Greece, Rome, the Persian civilizations. So Manly took very seriously the idea that there was, in fact, an ancient ideal of a setting, a polity, a society, where the individual search for meaning was protected. So for him, the speech of the unknown, whether it was fact, fiction, metaphor, or maybe a mixture of all these, did capture an ideal. It did serve to encapsulate a chapter of human progress that was given birth to in the American nation. So Manley took it seriously. And Reagan, well, you tell him a good story and he repeats it, you know. He first used this story at a commencement speech that he gave at Eureka College, his alma mater, in 1957. So to me, that sort of deepened the connection, because Reagan was using this story from the earliest vestiges of his political career, when he was still gravitating from being an actor to becoming a politician. And he repeated this story not only in the first term of his administration, but on television at the centenary celebration of the Statue of Liberty with President François Mitterrand of France sitting next to him. So it meant something to him. President Gerald Ford, who was actually the last full-fledged Freemason in the White House, the mysterious Gerald Ford, he said that in meeting Reagan, he found him very interesting because he said, you have to watch Reagan's public statements very carefully, because Reagan is one of these people who will disclose more about himself in his public statements than in private conversation. He said, you know, in private, Reagan could be very guarded, but in public, he tended to wear his heart on his sleeve, so to speak. Hence, it's very, very interesting and important for the historian to look at Reagan's speeches, articles, public statements. So here we have this essay that Reagan hand wrote on a yellow legal pad that is a leaf directly out of Manly P. Hall's 1944 book, The Secret Destiny of America. And Manly himself received it through his community with Theosophy and his love and admiration for Madame Blavatsky. Is there nowhere that we don't feel HPB's influence today?
North Korea?
Well, the nation of South Korea is certainly interested in the metaphysical. Maybe things will be smuggled across the border. In popular culture, Madame Blavatsky's influence ranges far and wide. There are times where she'll be satirized. There are television shows that will occasionally have some sort of a robed medium where they're making fun of Madame Blavatsky. She made an appearance on the cartoon Beavis and Butthead, with my historian colleague Michael Gomes was kind enough to direct me to. There are television shows where she or other theosophical figures will appear. So, you know, she sort of pops up here and there in interesting cultural places. But there's a much deeper influence, and it goes back to some of what I was talking about in my previous presentation, which is that Madame Blavatsky, again, she opened the Western mind in its contemporary state to the idea of a man of wisdom and of the search as something that could be undertaken by the individual who, whether he or she would ever find this man of wisdom, might find a community where the influence of this figure is felt, and where there are living teachings that are very useful to the individual. After Madame Blavatsky, after her influence was felt on American culture and on Western culture in general, and of course Eastern culture, there was a upsurge of literature in which masters seemed to be everywhere, you know, They were walking the aisles at Kmart. They were everywhere you went to help you out. It became a theme, a dominant theme of American culture, that everywhere you looked, you could find these masters of wisdom who would lend a hand. You can detect it in places that are quite surprising, for example. Carlos Castaneda became famous and in some regards infamous for writing a series of books about his dialogues with a hidden master in Mexico in the American Southwest named Don Juan, a sorcerer who imparted all these insights of life and magical ceremonies to him. That is exactly a distant offspring of the mythos that Madame Blavatsky brought to America. And when I use that term mythos, I'm using it in the sense that Stefan Heller brought, in which a myth is truer than physical fact. People run down Carlos Castaneda quite a bit. He's another one of these people who is officially dismissed as having been a fake. And believe me, I've done the forensics on Carlos's life, and he was quite the dramatist, quite the dramatist. But nonetheless, and I've had this discussion with deeply seeking people who have been teachers to me, there's truth in his books. There's truth in his books. I love Carlos Castaneda. He had an unusual quality, I think. You know, I've talked to people who met him, and he could present a very different face to different people. Some people saw him as this outrageous, weird guy. Other people saw him as a shy, appealing young man back in his early days. He appeared differently to different people, but only those who do not believe in the idea of a master of wisdom cannot understand what it is that's so compelling about Carlos's books. You know, and I get it. I've looked into Carlos's life, and yes, you know, he was different things to different people. He created a lot of mystery around himself. He was a dramatist. But boy, oh boy, if you've been on this path for a little while, you read Carlos's books, and there's something electrical and alive there. Now, my favorite figure from the New Thought tradition is someone that some of you may have heard of named Neville Goddard. Does anybody know Neville, the work of Neville? I love Neville. Neville was a Barbados-born Englishman who lived in Barbados, born in Barbados in 1905, came to New York City at a very young age to study theater, fell in with a variety of metaphysical groups, and in short, Neville came to feel that he had discovered the simple radical truth of life, which is that our thoughts are causative, in his view, that the human imagination is what the Hebrews referred to in Scripture as God, and that the mind is a creative force. And I assure you, Neville, he died in 1972. He wrote with such elegance and grace. He was quite formidable and quite capable of defending his point of view. I think there's a paucity of intellectual strength in the New Thought movement, and I'm trying my best to bring what fiber I can to that movement, because I do believe it has truths, and I love that movement, and I see myself as part of that movement. But aside from a few figures like Ernest Holmes and Neville Goddard, there is a paucity of intellectual strength in that movement, and that should be remedied, because I think there are good ideas there, and I think there's truth there. And Neville, for however radical what I just described may sound, he was very capable of defending his point of view with great elegance and with great simplicity. Neville, too, told a story that, wouldn't you know, he was tutored by a hidden master of wisdom. Isn't it amazing, all these masters? He referred to his master of wisdom as a man named Abdullah, who he said was a black Jewish rabbi of Ethiopian descent who tutored him in the early 1930s in Kabbalah, number symbolism, scriptural symbolism, other traditions, and that's where he got his ideas from, and he went off out into the world. Now, ever since I've started researching and writing about Neville, people have said to me, who's Abdullah? Who's Abdullah? And for a while, I thought to myself, you know, this is just an invention. I mean, this is just a device. It's a metaphor. Maybe it's a consortium of people. Truthfully, the question wasn't that important to me, because when you start to go down that road, you know, it can really twist and turn, and you can get very lost. You can spend your whole life seeking after mysteries and miracles and so forth and forgetting why any of it matters in the first place. But I did come upon a figure who I think might have been Abdullah or might have been part of a composite of Abdullah. Something that has been lost to our history and that is not well understood. I write about this in One Simple Idea, which is a history of new thought and positive thinking metaphysics, is that many of the radical political movements in our country in the progressive era and in the early 20th century had a metaphysics. They were very interested in Madame Blavatsky and other ideas because they felt, well, let's, you know, try every tool in the tool belt. Let's see if the human spirit can be liberated economically, psychologically, in terms of gender, and spiritually. And the black nationalist Marcus Garvey was very interested in positive mind metaphysics, and I write about this extensively in Occult America. Marcus Garvey used statements that were, again, a leaf directly out of the New Thought movement. You find telltale phraseology and such. There was a guy, a black rabbi, who served as the musical director of Marcus Garvey's organization in the early 1930s, at the same time that Neville lived in New York City, whose name was Arnold Josiah Ford. He was part of what at that time was known as the Black Hebrew Movement. It was a precursor to Jamaican Rastafarianism. If you know the figure Bob Marley or other figures from the popular culture of Jamaica, you'll have a sense of what Rastafarianism is. The Rastafarians believed that they are part of a lost tribe of Israel that has a deep and ancient connection to Ethiopia, which does, in fact, have an African Jewish community. And Ford was part of this movement, sometimes called Ethiopianism, in which he believed that the true destiny of the black people was one of rediscovering their Judaic descent and reconnecting physically with Ethiopia, where this wayward tribe of the Hebrews had gone to live. These are not leaps of fantasy, because there is an ancient Jewish movement in Ethiopia, and the Mediterranean and North Africa are, globally speaking, part of the same neighborhood. This is not fantasy. So Ford, in this Ethiopianism movement, also had a mental metaphysics. Like Garvey, he imbibed many ideas from New Thought, from Christian Science, certain aspects of Kabbalah. And Ethiopianism was a movement that saw itself as primevally Jewish, as possessed of a mental metaphysics, and Arnold Josiah Ford referred to himself and was regarded as a rabbi. And there are a few surviving portraits of him. He looks remarkably like the description that Neville gives in his lectures of a African-American man with a turban, a very stern, almost severe appearance. It also happens that Arnold Ford, like Neville, was a native of Barbados, and he too traveled to New York City to find his way in the world. And in fact, Ford, in the early 1930s, relocated to the nation of Ethiopia, because after the coronation of the Emperor Haile Selassie, who some of you have probably heard of, Haile Selassie offered land grants to any black American who was willing to relocate to Ethiopia, because Haile Selassie liked this idea that Ethiopia, which is an enormous nation, would serve as this kind of pan-African gathering place for the African diaspora. So he wanted people from the Americas, from the Caribbean, from other parts of Africa to come to Ethiopia. He saw Ethiopia as a kind of cultural superpower. And he was very sympathetic to Garvey and to the early Ethiopianism movement. So Ford did move there. And there are very, very few records of Ford's life once he got there. But I can only surmise it was a difficult life because you have a man from metropolitan circumstances who is relocating to an agrarian lifestyle. These land grants, you know, weren't in the middle of cities. I mean, you were given a piece of land and expected to farm it, kind of like the kibbutz movement in Israel. And Ford died in the mid-1930s, just a few weeks before Mussolini's fascist troops crossed the border of Ethiopia and invaded the nation. I can only imagine it was a very difficult existence that he had spent there, but the period is so sadly absent of records. But so I'm not so sure that Abdullah was just this invention of Neville's. It may have been a composite of people. It may have been Arnold Josiah Ford, whose name he changed. I think, frankly, Neville is going to become, and is in the process of becoming, the voice of the greatest posterity from the New Thought movement. He was a really formidable intellect. He was an elegant figure, a lovely man who could speak with tremendous grace. He had encyclopedic knowledge of scripture. Every time he spoke, he restated the same general thesis, but he stated it with a freshness so that you felt like you were hearing it for the very first time. And as I write about in a recent essay, Neville is actually the figure from the New Thought tradition whose thought comports best with the debate or the conversation around metaphysics and quantum physics. And I part with these critics who claim that the notion that quantum physics has anything for the spiritual seeker is a New Age fantasy. It's not a New Age fantasy. It's not a New Age fantasy. It's like anything else. If you approach it seriously, you can have a conversation. There is no reason why students of physics and serious students of metaphysics cannot have a conversation. And that conversation is happening. It's happening right now. So people can hoot and complain all they want. It's going on. And I think that Neville is a bridge of sorts between the people who want to have that conversation. His work, I think, has done the best job within the New Thought tradition. And this is a man who died in 1972 of capturing some of the metaphysical insights that might exist within quantum theory. So if you haven't heard of him, check him out, and you'll be hearing more of him, because I think he's going to become the voice emergent from that movement that becomes best known. His name has been much more widely heard, say, today, than when I first started writing about him about 12 years ago. So Neville, too, was a guy who imbibed this idea that he could receive wisdom from this hard-to-place, out-of-the-way spiritual master, maybe someone from an exotic land, maybe someone from the East. And of course, lots of people make these claims today, and many of them are dubious. Many of them are dubious. I don't know whether I should name names. Do you want me to give you names and phone numbers? And this guy in San Jose, we're going to fix him. But regardless of the varying quality of the work that grows out of these claims, it is a foundational part of the Western consciousness today, a foundational part of the Western consciousness today. As Michael Gomes has pointed out, when the Beatles traveled to Rishikesh in India in 1967 to spend time with the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, the founder of transcendental meditation, Madame Blavatsky had laid the groundwork for that pilgrimage to take place, because before her, there was no concept in the Western mind that you could make such a pilgrimage to the East and seek out the man of wisdom and seek at his feet. gleaning wisdom. That wouldn't have happened a century before. There wouldn't have been any context for understanding it. So, HPB versus Darth Vader. Who wins? HPB wins. Because that's the good news. We are able, I maintain, to imbibe mass entertainment like Star Wars because of the mythos that HPB reignited in the Western mind. Let me tell you, when you look at the figure of Yoda in his robes, with his riddles and his enigmas, everyone in this society and many places around the world is immediately able to place that in context because of the influence that Madame Blavatsky brought into our culture. Yes, we had Merlin. Yes, we had the prophets. Yes, we had the idea of a spiritual journey, more a material journey or a journey of self-awareness. But the notion that you could take a pilgrimage to somebody who could provide you with this vital, life-saving help, that there was some non-physical aspect to life necessary to complete our sense of existence, like the eye in the pyramid on the back of the dollar bill. That robed figure with his enigmas and his learning and his capacity to mentor the young initiate, we wouldn't be able to understand that language as a global culture today if it weren't for Madame Blavatsky, which is why there is no jar, no label that will ever be big enough to contain her. And I would submit to you, she almost left us with a gift in the enigma that she was. Because I think the greatest health of our intellectual culture is measurable by the extent to which we're able to hold a question. The moment we want to start putting things into museum cases, something dies, something is lost. It's what HPB was responding to in the late 19th century. It's what Manly Hall was responding to in the early decades of the 20th century and beyond. The extent to which we can hold a question about this woman is a measure of the health of our intellectual culture. So I say to all of you, keep holding the question. And thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Two of the most successful forms of the New Thought movement in this century have been Jerry and Esther Hicks' Abraham teachings and Rhonda Byrne's The Secret. Mm-hmm. Could you comment on those two, your own personal opinion on them and how you see them fitting in?
Sure. First, to speak to Rhonda, I mean, everyone in our culture professes to hate The Secret. You know, I've never met anyone anywhere on the New Age or at any conference who doesn't want to clear that up with me immediately, how they hate The Secret. So I'm not quite sure, you know, who bought all those books or who watched the movie on download 10 million times, but everyone hates it. I have a lot of criticism of Rhonda Byrne. My chief criticism of Rhonda is that she promulgates the idea of this one overarching mental super law that controls everything. And I reject that because I think we live under many laws and forces. And I think she paints herself into this ethically indefensible position. And she was asked, inevitably, by an Associated Press reporter several years ago, well, if you believe that the law of attraction controls everything, what do you say about the victims of 9/11? What do you say about the victims of the Holocaust? And Rhonda replied, well, I do believe that the law of attraction controls everything, and those people may have been vibrating on the same frequency of those events, therefore saying that, yes, their thoughts, one way or another, brought them to this catastrophe, to this demise. I completely disagree with that on several levels. One of the levels on which I disagree with it is this. The only empiricism that's really available to us on the spiritual path is our own experience, our own experience. If I start to explain away my neighbor's suffering, I'm doing nothing more than throwing a rock at him. It avails me of nothing. It avails him of nothing. Self-experience is the empiricism of the spiritual path. I don't think that she or I or anybody should be talking about events that they haven't experienced. If you haven't been in a catastrophe like that, there is no place for you to be talking about it and saying what people undergo. So that's one level, and I have deep disagreements with her on other levels too, because my feeling is, look, you can research and be interested in non-physical or causative properties of the mind without concluding that it's the only force we live under. Why would you have to jump to that conclusion? Or why would you have to jump to the conclusion that its cause and effect is decipherable, or that its experience is always felt on us in uniform ways? Gravity is a uniform law. A law has to be uniform, right? But you experience gravity differently here on Earth than you would if you were on the moon or on Jupiter, because there's also a law of mass. It doesn't mean gravity's changed. There's greater mass or lesser mass, so you're going to experience it differently. Why would you have to jump to this conclusion that we live under one law in order to pursue questions about non-physical properties of the mind? So one of the things I'm trying to accomplish in New Thought, and I write about this in my book, One Simple Idea, is I do believe there are good ideas there, but it needs a much, much better intellectual culture. It has stopped growing. It has stopped refining itself. When William James died in 1910, we lost our last really great voice, I think, who was interested in the challenge posed by New Thought. And I do believe it has truths, and I do believe there is good, clean water there to drink, but it must be refined. It must be refined. About the Hickses, you know, I feel much the same way. I mean, I can find areas where I think they have an insight and areas where I have exactly the same problem with them as I do with Rhonda. Yeah, thanks.
I had a question that's open speculation, and I'm hoping you might help with. On the theme of popular culture that sort of HPP sits at the root of, it's my belief from many examples that Stan Lee of Marvel Comics fame
is
deeply influenced by this movement, but I don't know the chain. I don't know where it's coming
from.
You
read my mind. Thank you. I was just thinking about this morning. In a few weeks, there'll be a movie released, Doctor Strange, which is also going to play out one of HPP's themes again. The material man, the man who has nothing to learn from the weird, mist-shrouded East, who has to make a journey, find a spiritual master, learn his craft so he can come back and fight bank robbers here in America. that character was devised by Stan Lee and one of my favorite artists of all time, Steve Ditko, a wonderful, wonderful comic book artist, who is a funny man because he's very dedicated to the philosophy of Ayn Rand. Ayn Rand rejects the mystical, not always in ways that are opposed to us exactly, but you know, here's Doctor Strange, who's this popular manifestation of mystical ideas. Steve Ditko and Stan Lee create this character, Doctor Strange. The movie's going to be out in a few weeks. You'll be able to get his picture on, you know, the free cups at McDonald's and so forth. So have a good time. But the whole mythos and journey of Doctor Strange, a Westerner who sneers at the East, who suffers crises, who is forced to go to the East to learn wisdom, come back, and become a kind of hero, it comes straight from the mythos of the masters. I don't know precisely where Stan Lee and Steve Ditko were getting the ideas from, because Steve Ditko doesn't talk to anybody. And, you know, Stan is sort of like, you know, he's perpetually like, hey, everything's great. And, you know, he doesn't care too much about talking about the roots of these things. But a friend of mine, Kat Ironwood, who's a wonderful historian of comics, said to me that she thought they were probably getting their ideas from the novelist Sax Rohmer. And he wrote the Fu Manchu series. He also wrote an interesting popular book called The Romance of Sorcery, which came out in 1912. And I tell you, he has a very respectful, not bad chapter in there about Madame Blavatsky. So she thought that Stan Lee and Steve Ditko, the creators of Doctor Strange, were getting their ideas from Sax Rohmer. And, you know, I read his chapter on Madame Blavatsky, and I thought, you know, that's not too bad. That's a lot better than what's coming out of some current scholarship. And it's a popular look at her, to be sure, but it's a respectful one, and I think historically it's reasonable.
First, I wanted to compliment you on the fact that you point out where this movement has succeeded. It's something I needed to be reminded of, and which I think we always need to be reminded of. We expect the theosophy to appear in certain forms. Mm-hmm. It doesn't necessarily appear in those forms.
Right, right.
Houston Smith wrote in Appreciation of the New Age, it may have been in The Doors of Perception, I'm not sure, and he gives a list. Are you familiar with what I'm referencing?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think that's a good reminder. Anyway, Ascended Masters.
Yeah.
Do you know the history of that term?
I
know
I do.
It's not theosophical, but
correct.
It's always associated with Madame Blavatsky and
right.
Theosophy.
Right. I write about this in Occult America, actually. The term was first used by a Chicago couple named Guy and Edna Ballard, who formed a kind of spirituality occult movement called the Mighty I Am. I wish their followers well. Some of their books are available at Quest Bookstore, which I think is a nice tribute to Quest Bookstore. I think it you know, was an invention. And I'm always very suspicious when, you know, I hear someone start off a conversation with me or start off their book making reference to the Ascended Masters, because it is a total bastardization of what HPB brought. And that term is from the 1930s. It's much newer than people often think. And part of the problem on the New Age, and again, I'm doing my best to work on this, is that we have no idea where we come from and how new some of these terms are. There are other new religious movements that have good archives and good historicism. Mormonism, Seventh-day Adventism, Christian Science, they maintain a wonderful archive. We lose this sense of lineage, and it makes us use these terms, as you rightly pointed out, in a kind of vapid way sometimes. But that is a new term, and that is an unwanted chip off Madame Blavatsky. Yeah, thank you.